When the university, along with the rest of the UK, went into lockdown, my immediate response was to place the School of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering, its expertise and resources, at the service of the NHS and COVID-19 frontline workers. How could we best make a contribution? Now, we could have made a small contribution being part of a design team or a supply chain for ventilators, or address the immediate need for personal protective equipment. Timing was of the essence. How could we best maximize impact in minimum time? Our frontline workers were in immediate need of face shields. And while there was a quick response from various volunteers to start manufacturing these using 3D printers, we opted for a faster method of production using laser cutting of flat polymer sheeting. And there are also certain shortcomings with 3D printed visors which could be mitigated using our approach. Of course, we could have considered injection molding or other types of manufacturing, but each entailed delays in getting to production. By utilizing the resources within our prototyping laboratory and the Polymer Processing Research Center that sits within the school, we were able to quickly develop a number of prototypes, which we then shared with senior medical staff for feedback. And the design that emerged was a lightweight yet robust face shield, which used different polymers. So for example, we used acrylic for the brim, we had polyethylene for the adjustable headbands, polyethylene terephthalate for the visor itself, and polyvinyl foam. And the choice was very much a balance between design requirements and material availability. It also had to meet certain standards addressing things such as field of vision, comfort, safety, and optical clarity. In field testing, certain features were particularly welcomed. The use of a transparent brim, for example, which allowed light through and did not cast a shadow over the eyes, like some of the 3D printed ones, which make use of opaque polymers, or even the thick foam used on disposable NHS-issued face shields. The brim also had no holes, so there was no possibility of downward aerosol reaching the eyes, and the shield itself was a good distance away from the face to comfortably accommodate an FFP3 mask. The headband also gave the face shield additional stability, which meant that the elastic around the head did not need to be tied so tightly, which added to the comfort over extended use. And the corners were also brought in to allow some sideways head movement. Now, I mention all this because through the feedback that we're able to get quickly, we were able to go into production 48 hours from initial concept. And since that time, we've delivered thousands to hospitals, nursing homes, St. John's Ambulance, and other places. And they've proved very popular. Indeed, when provisions from the NHS started arriving in hospital stores, medical staff asked us to continue providing their teams in preference of the standard issue. But to me, beyond doing my small bit to help, what was equally satisfying was the experience that this has provided in motivating staff whom I called upon to help realize this project. When we went into lockdown, I asked my technical staff whether they would be willing to assemble these shields. And within a few hours, my chief lab technician, who was also my health and safety coordinator, had set up socially distanced, fully equipped assembly and disinfecting stations, and also organized rosters for those technical staff who were in a position to help. Their enthusiasm and willingness to help was heartfelt and sincere. And I was reminded of Daniel Pink's book Drive, where he observed that the most deeply motivated people, not to mention those who are most productive, hitch their desires to a cause larger than themselves. And it ties in with what I've always tried to do within the school, adopting Simon Sinek's mantra, if I may call it such, of starting with why in everything that we do. I also made it a ritual to share every bit of positive feedback that we were receiving from grateful NHS staff with the rest of the team. It was an opportunity for me to also interact with staff within my organization at a frequency and level which my day-to-day job does not often allow. And as this project became a sizable operation, other volunteers followed, including a research project manager who started handling requests and prioritizing distribution, and my school's production manager, who was ever willing to update CAD drawings at short notice as we tweaked the design here and there, and then posted them on social media for others to use freely. So how may we emerge as a school once this pandemic is over? Well, there's certainly a wider piece to consider around higher education in general. But from my perspective, as a head of a research-intensive school with degree programs in aerospace, mechanical, and production design engineering, how might this experience change what we do? And more importantly, how we interact with each other? Will my risk register now include such unlikely yet plausible events? And have in place an agile and responsive design and manufacturing capability to deal with whatever may be required, perhaps even linked with the rest of the UK and Ireland. Indeed, we have just embarked on the design of an intubation shield at the request of medical surgeons. Now, will my academic staff find new inspiration in their research and teaching endeavors? And how can I and the school management team provide opportunities for all staff to further enhance their sense of purpose and to pursue heuristic work? Time will tell. But above all, I hope to tap into the intrinsic motivation that has driven this face shield team to excel. And who knows, perhaps this will lead to a level of collegiality, understanding, and concern for each other's well-being that will result in an even better place than the one we left behind at the start of lockdown. Thank you.